Okay, good morning all. Let me start the lecture since it is 8 o'clock already. And I first like to demonstrate you guys about the inference line diagram. Let's see, most of the inference line diagram can use in the analysis and in the design of the crane, or in the design of a beam of a bridge, okay? You guys know that the beam of the bridge, when it's subjected to the load that applied to the bridge is the movable load. Most of them come from the vehicle weight. At least we have two loading points for this car. Or if we have the head of the semi-trailer. For this one, you have three loading points. Or if we have the semi-trailer full of them using the bridge, so we have five loading points, include two more from the car. The concept of inference line diagram start with a simple one. It just said, okay, let us consider only a point load, okay, that move from one point to the other point. For example, this way you are coming from Bangkok to Kolat. A is Bangkok, this is Kolat, okay, the way to go to. Or you can go the other way. So first of all, the load can move in two ways. And then there are three ways to draw the inference line diagram. For example, if this beam is 20 meter long, okay, and then your car move. When your car move, we just assume that, okay, let us consider only one loading point and let the loading point to be one unit. Why? When the loading point change to the weight of the car, just time it. If this is 5 kilonewton, this is 5 kilonewton, we just multiply 5 kilonewton with one unit. So it can represent anything. So generally, and make it the simplest way, just consider this one as a unit load. And then you set this as a reference line, and the length of the beam is X. That means this X zero. This X is 10 meter. This X is 15 meter. This X is 20 meter. And then when the load comes, you may use your feeling. When the load is here, the total one unit force will transfer directly to this support. And most of the time, if this is a bridge, this is going to be the cross beam. And under the cross beam is the pier. Under the pier is the footing. So the 1 point unit load transfer to the cross beam, transfer to the pier, and transfer to the foundation. So you can use this load to design everything under it. When there's move, for example, if it's move here, the load that's transfer to here gonna get smaller than one. And the load here, when we start here, the load here is one, the load here is zero. When we come here, the load here is less than one. And the load here start to be get larger. When it's at the 10 meter, the load here is 0.5, the load here is 0.5 due to the symmetry of the beam. And when the load start to be here, which is close to this, for example, B. This load gonna be, reaction gonna be larger. Reaction gonna be, oh here, at A gonna be smaller. And then when the load come here, the reaction here is zero. Reaction here is 1.0. So if we just consider only the support A, when we consider the support A, when load here, this is 1.0. When the load here is less than 1.0, when the load at the middle is 0.5, when the load is here is less than 0.5 when the load is here reaction here is zero so professor Musler-Bessler said if you like to draw the diagram of the inference line you release the a sub y out and then you use the a sub y push this one to unit load so you will get the coordinate of this one as 1.0 that is equal to when the weight is here and the coordinate over here is 0.5 when the load is over here the reaction here is 0.5 and when the load is here when the load is here the reaction here is zero okay and when we consider the reaction at the beam we do again release the resistance of the B sub Y and let the B sub Y push this one up for one unit so what it means is when the load is here the B sub Y is zero when the load is at the middle the load B sub Y equal to coordinate here is 0.5 when the load is here B sub Y is 1.0 is the coordinate here okay this is what this is very good to design the cross beam of the bridge to design the pier of the bridge to design the foundation of the bridge and for the reaction in our reality the load does move along this beam will produce the reaction here and produce the reaction here depend on the coordinate of this car okay if this car is at the middle and let it has 5 kilonewton and 5 kilonewton the length between the distance between the wheel is 2 meter and just park half of this one at the middle of the car so 5 kilonewton here will transfer to here and 5 kilonewton here will transfer to here and can we consider it yes we can consider it for example if we like to find the reaction of the car sorry the reaction at point A due to the car we can use the inference line diagram that we have previously that we have is what the inference line diagram that we have a shape like this okay by doing this is what is the triangle and then the 5 kilonewton here gonna have the coordinate of 1 and then you guys know that this is 20 meter and this is 2 meter so the coordinate of the second wheel here is going to be 0.9 so what we have is 1 times 0.5 0.9 times 0.5 so the load here is going to be 9.5 okay but most of the time the load that acts on the beam is not just the two wheeler or from the car if the load the vehicle changed to the semi trailer so you got to time this by the coordinate 1 and then you got to time this by coordinate here got to time this by coordinate here got to time this by coordinate here got to time this by coordinate and sum them together okay that's gonna produce a case for the reaction at A however since the truck can move in the other way for example the truck also can move back for example this way they move to collapse okay this is another situation that produces the reaction at A and also you may put the vehicle in this situation whatsoever it is so when you do this you going to find the loading pattern that produces the maximum of the reaction at the A and then you use that maximum reaction or maximum influence from the set of loading to decide the cross beam to decide the pier to decide the foundation okay and then not only that we also have another thing. For example, if this is the steel beam, and then you also need to what the beam is 20 meter, and then you cannot build the steel beam 20 meter long. You got to buy the steel, for example, 15 meter, and then 5 meter, and then you weld them together. The second thing, if you like to design the welding of the steel beam, when you design the welding of steel beam, you require to find the maximum shear due to the set of loading. What it means is, first, again, you got to draw the inference line diagram. Like the previous one, you draw the inference line diagram of A sub Y, and then you determine the A sub Y by moving the position of the vehicle, and then you time the weight by the coordinate, and then you sum them together. But this time, you need to determine the shear. Professor Muller said, if you like to draw the inference line diagram of the shear, you just put the slider here. And then you put the one down and put the one up due to what? Due to the positive shear. So what we have is, let's move this a little bit. What we have is, over here, we will have the inference line diagram, the downward size. And let's say this is 5 meter. So this is will be minus 5/20. That is going to be minus 1/4. This is minus 0.25. Okay, this is minus 0.25. Let me put it a little bit downward. Okay. Okay, yeah. And then over here on the top, there is the inference line diagram. The coordinate here is going to be B over L. That is going to be 15/20. So you got this coordinate of 0.75. And then when you have the vehicle like this, and you can move this vehicle in two ways again. But now you can see over here the inference over here, the red pen is negative. So if you like to find the inference of the shear at this building point, you supposed to put all the weight on the positive one to produce what? To produce the positive effect for the shear at the sea. Okay, and also there is two way of movement of the semi-trailer. You also need to consider there is other way like this. Okay, and you may put this one, since this have 5 loading points, this one, and this one. And for sure, the maximum supposed to be something like this. But anyway, we got to do the trial earlier. Now, this one have the negative and the positive effect. And since the positive has higher inference, so you got to concentrate on putting the load on the positive effects, okay? And the last one, at this point, that's you got to what? You got to decide the welding. So the other requirement is finding the maximum bending. So Professor Muller said, you put the hinge here. And then you use the moment M sub C, just open this one up. And then you have what? You have this file of inference line diagram. The height here is going to be A times B, 5 times 15 divided by 20. So this is going to be 15 divided by 4. Okay, and then you can what? You can put the load here. Now, the effect all is positive. So you may put this one, that is going to produce each case. This produce the M sub C one. This is going to build M sub C two. This is going to build M sub C three. This is also going to produce M sub C four. Okay, 5 may not be the maximum. And then you do another way. You push the touch here. This is M sub C. 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. That is 10 cases actually, but some of them you sure is going to produce very small moment, for example, like this one. This should produce less than, and also for some kind of this one, it won't produce the maximum moment, but the maximum maybe come from the tug when the tug is here, or when the tug is something about this. Okay, so this is for finding the maximum influence of the loading of the semi-trailer to find the maximum shear here, to find the maximum moment here, to design the wielding here. Okay, now before we finish the influence line diagram, we come to the design of the whole beam. And we know that for the simple beam, that's maybe the simple crane also. There is a lot of simple crane. When we said the simply supported crane, most of the crane use the steel to build it. But when we talking about the bridge, the pre-stress, pre-cast, pre-stress concrete bridge, most of the time is just built in the whole unit. No wielding point. By doing that, we consider the absolute maximum moment. And everybody know about the beam. Most of the time when the beam subjected to the load, for example, if it's subjected to the uniformly distributed load across it, the maximum moment gonna occur at the middle of this bridge. But when the bridge subjected to this set of loading, the maximum bending is unnecessarily to occur at the middle, but most of the time it will occur under the view of the loading. For example, it maybe occur under this load for some kind of loading pattern of this semi-truck on the beam, okay? And it also may occur under this, depend on how we put the load onto the beam. And then for the last section of the inference line diagram, we have to find the absolute maximum moment on this simply supported beam. If you work in the highway department, you're going to use a lot of this in your analysis, okay? And by doing this, let me set, okay, this as the center of the beam. Let me mark this at the center of our girder. And how do we do it? The first step, we're going to determine the resultant force. We combine, for example, this is going to be 5, 10, 10, 10, 10. That is going to be F sub R is going to be 45 kilonewton. And then the 45 kilonewton will apply somewhere here. Okay, you can determine the distance between this reference point into the F sub R. Yes, we use the concept of equivalent moment. And when you find this, we set this one as the X bar. Okay. And then let's say the X bar is the distance. Let's say the F sub R is here and the reference is here. So we divide the distance here by a half. And then we put that half onto the middle of the beam like this. Okay, then this is the first case and the maximum moment will occur at the loading point. That's close to the middle of the midspan of the beam. Okay, this is going to be the first case. And then there is another one that is going to check between this position, okay, of F sub R to this one. So you move this one to another position here. Now the load is here that forces to the midspan. So the next case, the maximum moment will occur here. And then you compare them together. You get what? You get two moments. And one of them going to be the absolute maximum moment. So what I have here is trying to show you the way the inference line diagram can be used in our design of the P-class, P-state girder in a bitch, or in the three side of the steel crane. Now we come to the chapter 7. In the chapter 7, we talking about the deformation of the structure. And you guys know that the structure can change the shape under the application of the force. The same thing occur. Let us again consider this girder of the bridge. When this girder of the bridge subjected to the loading, for example, if the vehicle moving into this, and then what happened is, if this beam designed properly, the truck will pass the bridge smoothly. There is no crack in the beam. That means the beam have enough strength to resist the weight of this vehicle. Okay, both bending and shearing force. Okay, and that mean what? That mean we design the beam based on the strength of the material, the maximum stress due to the maximum moment that we discussed before is less than allowable stress. So the material is strong enough to resist the weight of this semi-trailer. Also, the shear maximum shear force produce the maximum shear stress. And then the beam can resist the maximum shear stress, the tau max, less than the tau allowable. Okay, that is the concept of strength design. There is another thing that you consider. If this truck is moving along the beam, but the beam, the girder of the beam design improperly, not good design. When the vehicle passing through it, and you can see the beam defect a lot like this. You can imagine if you dive a car or you dive a vehicle passing through the bridge and bridge deform like this, are you going to feel good? No, you're going to feel dangerous. Okay, so in the design of the bridge, not only we consider the absolute maximum shear, that's I talking about it when we start the lecture, that's occur at the support. Okay, we also consider the absolute maximum moment that occur at the area between the middle of the beam. And if you design it properly, this beam will have strength. The material of this beam will have strength large enough to carry the maximum shear, the absolute maximum shear, and carry the absolute maximum moment. But you need to check, the second thing is to check the deflection of the beam. All the beam we design should not deflect large like this. And since the mechanics of material we said, under the application of the force, the maximum deflection of this beam is less than L over 240 if under here have no wall. If over here has a wall, the deflection here should less than L over T30. Okay, because if it's larger than L over T30, the deflection will compress the wall and the wall may crack. Okay, and for the beam, the requirement for the stiffness is going to be larger. Since the span of the beam is 20 meters, if you design this one for example L over 400, that is going to be 20,000 millimeter divided by 400 or it's going to be 200 millimeter divided by 4. That means when the vehicle moving here, the reflection going to be 550 millimeter or 5 centimeter. That's good enough to produce the vibration if the deflection is large. And also the driver who drove the vehicle will feel something when you get the 50 millimeter or 5 centimeter deflection. So most of the time when we design the beam, whether it is designed by the steel or designed by the pre-stressed concrete, we will camber this beam a little bit, okay, by the pre-stressed stress or by camber the steel beam like this. So when the vehicle move, the deflection will not get like concave downwards like this. Okay, it will be at the neutral position and the vibration due to the vehicle passing through is going to getting really small. Okay, when we talking about the deflection, okay, in the building, thing going to be different from the bridge. Now, most of the time, the load that apply to the beam, for example, if this is the column, the load applied to this is going to be stay here. The load in the building most of the time is static, unlike in the bridge. Okay, anyway, when you consider this, how large is the deflection you allow to occur here? Like I said, if there is no wall here, is L over 240. If there is the wall under here, is L over 320. Okay. And when you design this beam, and when you go to the material testing, this is a kind of setup for three-point loading. By the three-point loading, the maximum deflection gonna occur at the midspan of the beam. Why? Because now the beam is symmetry, the loading is symmetry. So the deflection on the left and on the right of this beam is going to be symmetry. When it occurs, the deflection is going to be symmetry. The maximum is going to be occur at the middle, at the midspan of the beam. And this is going to be our maximum deflection if you reference it from the support. Okay, if you put large load, the maximum is going to be larger. And can you compute the deflection that's changing here under the load? When you change the load, the deflection change. Sure, because the Vmax that we learn from the mechanics of material and we learn from the material testing is going to be P. P is the weight here. Time L, the span length cube over 48 divided by EI. So what it means is P is said to be, let's say, 10 kilonewton. L is 20 meter power 3 divided by 48. And then there is two factors that you're going to consider is the E and the I. The E is what? The E is a fractional. Sorry, the E is modulus of elasticity. The I is what? The I is moment of inertia. When E time I, we call it EI. It is the fractional stiffness of the beam. Okay. So if you like to reduce the deflection of this beam, there is two ways. One, increase the E. Okay. Two, you increase the I. To increase the E, to increase the modulus of elasticity, you just change the material that you use to build this bridge. You know that the steel has the E of 200 gigapascal. The concrete has the modulus of elasticity about 20 to 40 gigapascal. So if you change from the concrete, maybe reinforced concrete or pre-stressed concrete, into the steel bridge with the same size of the section, okay, you reduce the deflection by 5 times. Okay, another way, you may change the way you design the bridge. If you design the bridge in this way and you put the load again, you can see the deflection is nearly zero. Because of what? Because the moment of inertia of this beam is larger than the previous one. Moment of inertia of this time is going to be 1 times 10 power 3. Sorry, VH. Okay, 1 times 10 power 3 divided by 12. But if you put it this way, it's going to deflect really easy. The moment of inertia is going to be 10 times 1 times 1 power 3 divided by 12. That is a lot different. The previous one, you get 1,000 divided by 12. But for this one, you get 10 times 1 cube divided by 12. You get 10 by 12. That's it, 100 times different. So when you put it, it's going to be easily to deform because the eye is smaller. But when you put it like this, it's going to be very tough to make it to have some deformation. It can resist very large load to get the deformation. Okay, that is two way to enhance, okay, the stiffness of the beam by increasing the flexural rigidity, EI. You may increase the E, you may change the E by changing the type of material. Or you also can change the I by putting the beam in the proper position. Or you may do both, change the E and change the I. That means in the design of the beam, that is two things. Most of the knowledge here from the mechanics of material until this subject, okay, we do the strength design. The structure can resist the maximum moment and can resist the maximum shear. But that is the deflection. For example here, if you put like this, you can see the deflection. You got to control the deflection to be as small as the building code specified. Okay, to let the structure stiff enough to reduce the vibration of the structure. So this is the introduction of the chapter 7. Previously is the cross, okay, lecture for the chapter 6. Now, let us come to the PowerPoint that we have. I did send the PowerPoint into our Facebook group, okay? And I hope you have this PowerPoint in your hand. Let me start that lecture over here. Okay, basis upon this is going to be the chapter 7. In the chapter 7 again, we're going to talking about the deflection of the beam. Deflection of the beam is a kind of the deformation of let's say structure. Is not only the beam, we also call the beam, we also call for the truss. Okay, we use the truss in the bridge, we use the truss in the loop, and also we are going to consider the frame. So this chapter going to concentrate first by the beam, and then later we will find the deformation of the truss and of the frame. And what we have from the one I just show you, if we have a simple beam and your simple beam subjected to a force, if the force is at the middle of this beam, the deformation of the beam on the left and the deformation of the beam on the right, okay, is going to be the same. And due to the symmetry of this deformation, we're going to get the Vmax here. And by doing this, we also observe that at this point of Vmax, the slope dv by dx here is going to be zero. Okay, that is important. We call the differentiation of v with respect to x is the slope. And by doing this, you also can see that we are going to have the slope here as the theta sub a, and the slope here as the theta sub b. We got to measure it with the tangent line, and due to the symmetry of the beam, we going to have theta sub a equal to theta sub b. So freq is mean what? Is mean is can bend. Okay, so when it said D, that means it can bend down. Actually, it can bend up. Defect is mean the deformation of the beam in the shape like this. And we just call the V is the deflection of the beam. And we call the differential of the deflection with respect to the X. When we said the X is going to be this, okay, direction, and we set the deflection in this way, so by doing this, the dV by the X can be determined. And you can see the first one from this point to this point, the slope gonna be negative, okay? And when it's least is zero, the slope here gonna be positive. When the slope change from negative to positive, this one is going to be the minimum, okay? Minimum point, or is going to be the lowest point, or is going to be the Vmax point, okay? And then we may consider the beam in the other way. If this beam is subjected to the uniformly distributed load, okay, that load going to put across the length of the beam. For example, this is the load from the one-way slab, and then the beam is going to be again in the form of symmetry beam as before. By doing this, the deflection of this beam on the left and deflection of this beam on the right, okay, they are going to be the same. But anyway, the Vmax here occur here. Vmax from this case and Vmax on this case are different. Vmax from this case can be computed from if load is P, the span is L, is going to be defined by PLQ divided by 48 EI. I don't know if you remember it or not, but we study about this from the mechanics of material already. And for this one, the Vmax is going to be 5W. If this force is W in, for example, 10 kilonewton per meter, P is just the point load, it's just 10 kilonewton, 5WL. This time, powerful, okay? When it's subjected to point load, it's just L power 3. When it's subjected to uniform load, it's L power 4. And then it's going to divide it by 384 EI. Okay? And then the shape of this deflection curve, we call shape of the deflection. We call this one as the elastic curve, and you can see the elastic curve from the second one and the elastic curve from the previous one will not the same. Okay, the equation that we determine from this one, the V sub X here gonna be something, and the V sub X here is going to be V sub X something, and you have this deflection table from the mechanics of material. So you can open this table and then you can find the equation that define the deflection of this simple beam subjected to the point load. And you can find this deflection equation of the simple beam subjected to the the uniformly distributed loop. Okay, there is another case for this when the simple beam again. Now this time is subjected to the point load, but let the point load have the position here. Okay, which is close to the pin support and far away from the roller support. And what we have here is the deflection of this beam will be get the shape like this. It's going to have large slope at the point of A and smaller slope at the point of B. By doing this, if you draw this shape and determine this one going to be theta sub A, and this one is going to be theta sub B when theta is the slope again. The slope theta sub A is going to be larger than theta sub B, unlike this one, theta sub A equal to theta sub B. So the deflection of this beam is going to be unsymmetric. Okay, and then the maximum deflection for this one will occur under the point that's going to be in the position between the load P and the mid span of the beam, and this one is going to be V max, and you can see this V max going to be something PLQ over something EI. Okay, and again, if this beam is subjected to the load that is similarity, for example, if the load is just putting half of this, again we have the deflection table that's used to determine the equation that represent the elastic curve of each case. Again, this one we will have another thing. This one the deflection will have the shape something like this, and then what we have is the slope that occur here, theta A is going to less than the slope occur here at the theta sub B, since this time the load is close to point B. Okay, and again, what we have is the maximum deflection is will occur at the point about here, and this is going to be V max. Okay, so on the first part of this, we like you to understand understand the deformation of the structure, okay? And the deformation of structure gonna cause the displacement, okay? The displacement and the deformation of the material, the deformation of the structure cause the displacement of a point, for example, of the displacement. And the displacement can be classified into two things. One is called the deflection. Another one called the slope. Okay. Of the statically determined structure, the structure gonna be beam. The structure gonna be frame. The structure gonna be thrust. And for the beam, there is another thing that's specified in the deflection table. Is called the cantilever beam. Okay, under the application of the can force at the cantilever beam, for example, if you put the load P like this, it's very easy. Just put this one ruler and put the load here. You can see this beam will have the small deformation like this. So by doing this, what we have the fixed end. At the fixed end, the slope is zero. At the fixed end, the deflection is zero. And then under the application of the force, this point move here. Okay, you see, this one is move here. The point, the force P, move this roller here. And then the elastic curve of this one is going to be something like this. And then if you set the point here gonna be A and the point here gonna be B, we going to set this is going to be the deflection V sub B. And if we draw the tangent line here and reference to the horizontal axis X of this beam, and this is going to be V, we going to have this one for theta sub B. So the notation of this call for the deflection and this one for the deformation. Okay. And again, for the beam at this one, you can use the ruler and show the deformation of this very easy. This is going to be the deformation of the simple beam subjected to the point load. Okay. But for the third one, you can see the shape is going to be something like this, as one that Ajahn said. So the elastic curve most of the time can be shown by using the ruler, okay? And that's going to help you, that's going to help us, that's going to help us to understand the deformation of the structure. Okay, that's going to be helpful by using this roller to do so. Okay, and then there is a number of method that we are going to use in the analysis of the displacement of the statically determined structure. It's going to be double integration. It's going to be superposition. These two methods we have studied them before in the mechanics of material. Let's you guys go back and check it out, review it, okay? And there is some more popular method such as the conjugate beam. The conjugate beam and the moment area is very similar. They are very similar concept. The moment area developed first, and then the conjugate beam was developed later. And the conjugate beam is more powerful than the moment area, okay, in the determination of the deflection of the beam. So I will concentrate the lecture on the conjugate beam. And later, we will go to the concept of work, okay? The method is called the virtual work. The nickname of this method called the unit load method. The unit load method can use to analyze the task, can use to analyze the beam, can use to analyze the frame based on assume a unit load apply into the structure, okay? And then we can compute the displacement of the task of the beam of the frame by using this method. And the concept of the unit load method also similar to the Castigliano theorem. And I will concentrate on the virtual load more than the Castigliano, okay, to focus your guide to the method that we should be excellent to. And if you prefer, you can go to my video clip to study about the Castigliano theorem and the moment area method later. Okay, but this is point. Let's move further. There are homework for the deflection of structure that you guys to work on. Two for the beam, one for the task, and two for the frame. Okay, and you supposed to use the specified method to solve each problem. And then you also need to use the structure to analyze the structure, the beam, to analyze the beam, to analyze the task, and to unlight the frame and compare the result from this computer program from your manual calculation. The result supposed to be very close to each other. If you get the different one, you got to check. Maybe your hand calculation is wrong. Or maybe you put something wrong in the computer program. That's going to produce the wrong output in the computer. If you put the wrong thing, or you put the junk into the computer will produce the junk back to you, okay? And then come to what we should consider before we go to consider to find the flexion and also the slope of static tree, the terminate structure. And I start by consider structure, by consider the precast pre-step or precast reinforced concrete. There is a new technique that we use to build the building nowadays by using the precast. We produce the structural member in the factory in order that during your construction of the foundation of this structure, you also can produce the column, you can produce the beam in the factory. And then when you cast the foundation, okay, finish it, you may put the precast. Most of the time it's a precast beam. Precast, maybe precast column also. And then you can be assembled it into the building at the construction site. And since the beam built by element, by each element, so most of the time you got to connect the end of the structure by welding the steel here and pour the concrete to connect them, make them monolithically work together, okay? And by doing that, the beam, most of the time when we decided, we may consider it for a safe design as the statically determined structure. And for the bridge, most of the time, as I mentioned before, is going to be precast, pre-stressed concrete bridge, okay? And you get the joint like this. When you cast it over here, you get the joint. The joints must be connect them together. And again, for a safe design, you can design this kind of beam member. For example, this beam connect between these two ends. You may consider this beam as the statically determined beam, okay? And then when you put the precast slab into the precast beam, the load will transfer from the slab to the beam. And then for this kind of beam, you may model it to be as the simple beam that's connect, okay? Here, maybe connect by the pin. It's up to you, you're an engineer, to check it. This is considered as the roller. And then the weight from the floor will transfer to the beam. And then the model of this precast beam is going to be subjected to W, for example, 10 kilonewton per meter. And the length here may be 4 meters. And then you can draw the shear diagram and you can draw the moment diagram. The shear diagram may have the shape like this, okay? And the moment diagram will may have the shape like this. And then you can determine here for the Fmax, and you can determine here for the Vmax. You decide the section of the beam based on Fmax, and then you check the section of the beam for the Vmax in which tau max less than tau allow. When you decide over here also, the sigma max gonna be less than sigma allow. And finally, you got to check the deflection of this beam. The maximum deflection that occur at the middle is depend on there is a wall here or not. If there is no wall here, the Vmax is going to be less than or equal to L over 240. This is an example of it, okay? And in the development of this precast, both reinforced concrete or the precast, precast beam, okay? There is Pican come to this university study master degree. He also developed the precast partially pre-stressed concrete beam, and he tests the real beam under the 4-point loading. They study what? Study the flexural behavior, and also consider the flexural failure of the structure that the concrete was tested until it's cracked, and then we check that the load that we test produce the M max, and then we compare the test M max, the tested M max with the one then designed, and then the M max from the test must be larger than the M max that we use in the design. This called proof test of the structural member. Okay, and Pichu Thong also work on this, but Pichu Thong work on the precast reinforced concrete beam. He also used the structure, the loading frame to test the structure, to test the precast beam. And then you can see this beam is what is previously is in the horizontal. And then when this one subjected to the load, you can see the beam under the load also have some deformation. And then there is crack, okay, occur in the beam. We going to prevent the crack, okay, prevent the crack during working load, during the working load. So we gonna check the load that we apply here is going to be how much, and then the load that occur here from the test must be larger than the load that we use in the design of this beam. Okay, and then there is other thing, not just we use this concept, okay, of testing of the structure in developing a new structure. We also can use this testing concept in the strengthening of the precast concrete slab. We have the slab, okay? And then for somehow, we're going to use this slab in the structure that required to support large loading, okay? Or you only have the building that use this precast slab in the building. And then you may change the function of the building from what, for example, from the residential, okay, building to the store to what, to hold the load of the commercial stuff. So the design load that you use to design your building may be the life load of 300 kilogram per square meter. You got to change the function to store your good, to store your commercial stuff, the load may be increased to 600 kilogram per square meter. So you got to enhance the strength of this. You may put the steel plate underneath it. Okay, that is the work for P. P.
วิมล and then พี่นลิต come to work he used the carbon fiber reinforced plastic plate to attach to the bottom surface of this precast slab to increase what this one when you put this is going to increase the strength okay the strength of this precast slab and then when you put this one is also increase the stiffness of this precast slab and then we got to check whether the system we design here is strong and stiffness and stiff enough or not. We just put it in the loading frame and test it and check the what we measure here, both the P that we test is going to be larger than the P that we design. And the deformation that we test must be less than, okay, the deformation or the deflection. Let's say, may use this one, the deflection that we expected, that we can calculate, okay? The deflection must be small to make the structure stiff, okay? The deflection we test must be smaller than the deflection that we calculated, and the load that we test must be larger than the load that we design. So this one will consider strength, and this one we consider the stiffness. And there is something else about the material, such as this one. This is the new material. It's called pultrude fiber reinforced plastic or beam. We call it PFRP beam. This beam is made by the fiberglass. Is the fiberglass, and this fiberglass reinforced by polyester. Okay, this is a type of thermal setting material. Okay, it won't deform under the heat. Okay, and then they use a lot in the construction of the structure that should supposed to withstand the wrestling. Okay, the wrestling, such as in the sea shore. Okay, or such as in the water treatment plant. Okay, this thermal setting will protect the fiberglass, and then it can endure to the wrestling. It can be endure to the corrosion. Okay, this structure also has the other good thing, such as it has the light weight. It's really light. It's 4 or 5 times lighter than steel, and it can be 2 times lighter than aluminum. Okay, it also have high strength. Okay, it has high strength. The strength is close to the steel, but the structure has drawback. It has low stiffness. What we have is this structure has low modulus of elasticity. So in the design of this structure, most of the time the design will control by the deflection. So the concept to design of this beam is different when we design the steel beam. The steel beam, most of the time the deflection design control by the strength. But this one, the design controlled by stiffness. Okay, this is a work of Pete Jackson. Okay, and there are other things. The deformation not only occur in the beam, it also occur in the column. I just show you about it. So deformation, okay, is going to relate to the stiffness of the structure. We cannot provide the structure with large deformation. We going to control the deformation to a specific or a given point. That means the structure supposed to have small deformation. Not matter it is a truss, it is a beam, it is a column, or it is a frame. Okay. So let us start analyze of the deflection. Okay, the deflection is the basis for analyze of the statically indeterminate. Next chapter, the chapter 8, we will consider the beam, we will consider the truss, we will consider the frame. That is statically indeterminate. That mean what? That mean you guys supposed to be good in this chapter before you can work in the next chapter. And then the deflection is used in the analysis and design of structure to prevent large deformation. Okay, large deformation will produce vibration into the structure. Okay, and large deformation like this, what is going to make the function of the structure, make the function of structure deficient, or make it malfunction. Or also, if the structure is large, it may produce the crack of the structure. If there is a crack on the structure, and when the structure subjected to land, subjected to salt from the sea water, that kind of land will penetrate into this crack, and then it will make it will make the corrosion to the steel land reinforcement. So when the steel over here get corrosion, the strength of the reinforced concrete beam going to be downgrade. And the ability of resisting the force is going to be lower, and the structure may fail later. And then come to the deformation, there is two things. That means we are going to define the deformation. The deformation is the change of the shape, form, okay, D, okay, that's the change of the shape. The deformation produces the displacement. And you, if you combine the word, it's come from the word of place and this, okay? The displacement can be classified into one is the deflection. And the deflection can be over here, this one is the vertical. I should say this is going to be the vertical deflection, okay? This is going to be V sub Y or delta sub Y. We also have the horizontal deflection. Okay, that is going to be V sub F or delta sub F. This one will occur in the truss and it occur in the frame. And most of the time we didn't consider horizontal deflection in the beam. And then is the second thing that we got to consider of this is what? Is the slope. So this slope is the rotation of the beam. Okay, with respect to what? With respect to its original horizontal position, this is going to be clockwise. This is going to be clockwise. Okay, clockwise. นะฮะ soft clock clockwise rotation.Or clockwise slope. Okay, if you come to is a different way over here. This is going to call, let's say, from here to here. This is also called the slope, but it's going to be counter clockwise slope. So that is two way to consider the slope, okay? And two way consider the deflection. Consider the deflection can be the vertical deflection or the horizontal deflection for the frame, okay? When the frame subjected to the fault, the frame will deform like this. When the frame deform like this, the frame will has what I'm so called over here and here. That's called the horizontal deflection, okay? Or you may use it the delta, okay? Not only the frame has the vertical. This is going to be phi sub y or delta sub y, okay? And then the frame, when it's moved in the horizontal direction, we call this as the sideways. It's a kind of technical term, okay? It's a sideways. And the shape that we consider here, and the shape we consider here, we call that deformation shape of the structure as the elastic curve. An elastic curve simply called the deflection diagram that represent the deformation of the structure along its axis that's passing through the centroid of the structure. So usually the elastic curve can be considered as a line, okay? Like a line, represent the deformation of a structure, okay? And it's passing through the centroid of the cross section. The benefit of it, when we understand about the elastic curve, we understand the deformation of the structure under the load. For example, if we have simple beam, and this simple beam subjected to the point load is going to deflect like this. Okay, let me take this one out. Okay, let me come into this one. And if you have this, you may have this one as the deformation. You have the ruler to show it. You just put the point load here. This is the symmetry. Okay, the deformation is symmetry. If you put the load in this way, this beam, this ruler has no symmetry. It's unsymmetry deformation. Okay, and then if you just put this one as the fixed support, take from the lower, use this one as a pin, and you put it, you can see the deformation of this beam is changed. Okay, if you fix this, you put this a roller and you say the deformation of this one is changed. So the elastic curve of the structure will depend on the support that we put into the structure. Okay, by doing that, we come to the point here. Okay, we understand the deformation of the structure. As I showed you before, this is the first one. Okay, when you put this one in fixed support, and then you put it in fixed support, it's going to be something like this. If you put both of them as the fixed, if you put it as fixed, the structure is going to deform something like this. Okay, or for the bottom one, if you do it, you do is what in this way, right? When you put the load here, this is going to be the deformation of this beam, okay? The elastic curve can be demonstrated easily by the ruler. If you change this one to be the fixed, okay? This one change, if this one fixed, the change of the shape gonna be like this. If you change this one from fixed to pin, the change of this one going to be like this, okay? If we consider this one again, this is going to be the statically the indeterminate. Let's say this is going to be this one is statistically indeterminate beam. Okay, this is statistically determinate beam. Okay, no matter the structure is statically indeterminate or statically determinate. Okay, we can draw the elastic curve, and then in the next chapter, in this chapter and next chapter, first you should be able to draw the shear diagram. Second, you're going to be able to draw the moment diagram. And the third, you got to draw the elastic curve of the structure, or we call this is as the deflection diagram. And the last, not least, you got to draw the reinforcement, reinforcement pattern, okay, by using the elastic curve and the moment diagram. For example, when if you like to put the steel into this beam, and you know that under the application of this force, all of the member on this side is going to be in tension, right? And on the other side is going to be in compression. So for this beam, most of the reinforcement going to put it on the top, because we use the reinforcement to help the concrete to resist the tension. And there may be some other steel that we put on the bottom, but the black one gonna have the area less than the light blue one. Okay, and how about the other one? The other one on the top, we also can draw the reinforcement pattern. But in this way, you guys supposed to understand elastic curve of this beam. And if you got to design elastic curve of this beam, let me show you guys again. Okay. Let me show you guys again on this. Let me I should not share it. I should have show me which one is going to show myself. Anyway, I don't know you see me or not, but let me out of this sharing. Stop sharing. Okay, when we stop sharing, okay, you're going to have what? This beam is a kind of a little bit tricky one. One is fixed, one is pinned. When it's subjected to the load, you can see this part have the concave downward, and this part have the concave upward. Okay, and then let me go back to this one again. And what we have, this one going to have the tension on the bottom, and the top is going to be in compression. And there is a point here in which the curve change, because the curve here going to be in tension, over here going to be in compression. This is concave upward, change to concave downward. So there is a point here. The point here, we call it inflection point. Okay, in Thai we call it jut dat gap. It's changed from concave upward into to the concave downward. So by this way, we gonna put a lot of steel in this area and passing through this a little bit, have some some development linked here. And then we also put the steel in this area on the top, okay, for taking off the tension on the top. And then to make the beam can put the stirrup into it, there is some steel that has the smaller section that we put on the bottom and we put on the top, okay? And you should suppose to understand that this is the main reinforcement. We also need to put the stirrup, okay? This stirrup is most of the time we're going to put a lot of stirrup near the support, near the support, okay? And then for the area, at the area in the midspan, the stirrup can have the larger spacing, okay? Because of the shear in this area is small. And then when it's close to the support, the shear is large, the stirrup gonna get larger. So that is two things. And two things that we learned already is the shear diagram and moment diagram. And there is another two things that require you to learn from now is the elastic curve and the reinforcement pattern. And then the reinforcement pattern, you're going to use this concept in the pre-stressed concrete. And we going to use this one in the reinforced concrete in the next chapter. Okay, I hope you guys can see this screen already, right? Okay, now we go further. The benefit of this is just to check the possibility of our calculation. The deflection of this one will be respond with respect to the moment diagram. From the knowledge we have, we can find the reaction here. Okay, and then for this reaction, you also can find the shear diagram. This one may be downward here, okay? And then it's maybe upward here, okay? And then it's maybe downward here. It's maybe downward here. Why I know that? Because when we draw this one, this is going to have zero moment, and this is going zero moment. And then dm by dx equal to v. Okay, since this v is negative, so the slope here is negative. V here is positive, so slope here is positive. And v here is negative, the slope here is negative. Let's use the knowledge from the shear diagram and moment diagram to relate it to your problem. Okay, Ajahn, how do you know the slope here is zero? dv by dx equal to zero, because w here is zero. Okay, the same thing, w here is zero, the slope here is zero, and the slope here is zero. That's why I know the shear diagram gonna be here. And then by doing this, okay, you can use this one to draw this moment diagram. And from the moment diagram, you can see there is the positive moment and there is the negative moment. And this is what? This is a point that change the positive moment with the negative moment. We call again, this called the inflection point. Okay, we call this one inflection point. And by different inflection point, we can draw the elastic curve of this one by one. This is going to be pin. For the pin support, the deflection in the y direction is zero. The deflection in the x direction is zero. The slope at D is something. Okay, the slope at D is something. If this one is large, for example, if this one is 20 kilonewton and this one per se is 5 kilonewton, okay, the value of the moment here gonna be large, okay? The deflection of this beam will be drawn like this. Let me put this beam at the bottom, and then since this one has no deflection, yeah, it only can have the slope. Okay, and come to the point B. At the point B is the roller. Okay, is the roller V supply equal to zero, and theta at B not equal to zero, V sub X may not be equal to zero. Okay, this related to the reaction. If you call me, this going to have the D sub Y. It's going to have D sub X. When it have the D sub X, V sub X is zero. When it have D sub Y, V sub Y is zero. Since the moment here is zero, the moment M sub D is zero, the slope is not zero. So that mean what? That mean reaction will opposite to the deflection and slope. Okay, they are going to be in the opposite. If there is D sub X, V sub X equal to zero. If there is D sub Y, V sub Y is zero. If moment at D is zero, theta sub D is not zero. See, at the B also, at the B, B sub X is not zero. So V sub X is not zero, but usually for the beam is zero. The B sub Y is zero. B sub Y is not zero, sorry. B sub X, oh, I'm going to make a mistake. B sub X here is zero because it's a roller. This is the roller, B sub X is zero. V sub X is not zero. But this time there is the B sub X. B sub X not zero. There is some value. For example, it's going to be some kilonewton here. V sub Y is zero. They are in opposite to each other. And here, M sub B, that is M sub B here, right? This is internal load, M sub B. This might not be correct, just put it here. Okay, so what we have is what? What we have is over here, we have this one for theta sub D. And then over here is going to what? It's going to have what? It's going to concave downward to this point. So this one will have this kind of concave upward due to the positive moment. This is going to be in compression. This is going to be in tension. And this is going to be inflection point. And then the curve is going to be something like this. Okay, something like this. It's going to be this one going to be in tension, and this one going to be in compression. And depend on of this, if this is small, okay, this deformation over here, the deflection V sub A is going to be upward. Okay, and also this one you will have the theta sub A here. Because this one is what? This is free end. Okay, when we have the free end, we have the deflection and we have the slope. And this is maybe V sub A Y. And also most of the time, we also V sub A X, but V sub A X for the beam usually is zero because the beam have no elongation. And over here, we have what? Over here, we have theta sub B. Okay, and V sub B Y is zero. And V sub B X have the value something, but it's going to be very small. And over here, V sub D X is zero. V sub D Y is zero. but the slope is not zero. That is the value of the slope. Okay, you got to understand it to draw the elastic curve. So how we draw the elastic curve? Okay, we not only draw the shear diagram, we not only draw the moment diagram. This is going to be shear diagram. This is moment diagram. This may call it elastic curve. Okay, and we elastic curve. And how do we draw elastic curve? The first one I'm show you here, we consider the pin, we consider the roller, we consider the free end. So we use the support. The support that resists the force, such as D sub X, such as D sub Y, will restrict the deflection. V sub DX equal to zero. V sub DY equal to zero. Okay, and we have M sub D equal to, actually, in notation is not related. Okay, they are start by here. Okay, D sub X is going to be talking about the displacement, linear displacement V sub X. D sub Y talking about the linear displacement V sub Y. How about the beam that we have for the previous one, cantilever beam? Cantilever beam have this one is the fixed support. And then if you put the force into this beam, you will see the deflection of this gonna be something like this. As I just mentioned before, the theta sub A gonna be zero. The V sub AX is zero. Is V sub AY equal to zero? Because of what? Because under the application of the force, we has the reaction, and the reaction that we have related to this, this is going to be V sub A. Okay, this is gonna be N sub A, and this is gonna be M sub A, and each of them going to relate to the deformation. Okay, and we have the pin, we have the roller, we have the fix. Okay, we are an engineer. We are the one who specify the model. The model gonna be pin. When you give the detail of the construction for the pin, you got to give the correct detail of it. If you assume it's to be the fix, so you got to provide the detail of the construction and the fix. Okay, in conclusion, roller has the vertical reaction. So the displacement in the vertical direction is zero. The pin has horizontal and vertical. So the horizontal displacement or deflection and the vertical is zero. But the slope would, for the fixed, all of them are zero because they are all the reaction, the force reaction prevent linear displacement or prevent deflection. Okay, and moment prevent slope, prevent rotation for the moment. So the slope is zero when there is the value of the moment here. And we can draw the elastic curve easily. This one, just put this one, put the load here. You get the elastic curve of this one. Okay. And what I should say is, if the EI check, okay, for this one and this one are different. So what we have, if the load is the same, okay, and let's say this is going to be 1.5 EI. This is going to be EI. Compare the deflection of the above beam and the bottom beam. The bottom beam gonna have smaller deflection. it's going to have a smaller diffraction by 1.5 times. And then since the section change after that, the diffraction gonna follow the same thing. Okay, that's you got to understand about this also. And how about this? Okay, if you have the beam, you just put the moment into the beam like this. Okay, if I out of this, you put the beam like here, and then you put the moment like this. For the previous one, you put like this. This one, you put like this. So elastic curve, this one going to be something in this shape. And then what we have is the deflection of this one going to be have something like this. And you can see the top of this going to be in tension. This is going to be in tension, and this is going to be in compression. And if we have this one, the deflection going to be something like this. This is going to be in compression, and this is going to be in tension. You can represent this easily. And for also this one, this is going to be in compression, and then this is going to be in tension. But this one, the Vmax going to be here. For the between, actually Vmax can be here for this one also. This one, Vmax for the beam portion between B, C, D. Okay, and this one for sure, this one going to produce the Vmax. The Vmax here is going to be at the center. This is going to be Vmax. And the theta A and the theta B, they are going to be equal. But this one is unsymmetric beam, okay? When it said the beam is unsymmetry, the deflection will be unsymmetry, and then Vmax will occur in the area, okay? Near the midspan, okay? Near the midspan. And also at the Vmax, the slope gonna be zero, just I mentioned before. And how about this one? This one gonna have deflection something like this, okay? And then we will have this one for theta A, this one for theta B, and theta A gonna be larger than theta B. And again, if you dot this one at the midspan, you may see the deflection of this one supposed to be somewhere, this is not good drawing elastic curve here, somewhere supposed to be here. Just draw it again. Is going to be deflection going to be maximum about here, and then it's going to return back like this. And when this one is the maximum deflection, the slope here is going to be zero, okay? And for this one, I did for you already, okay? And this one, what? This is fixed. This is fixed. Theta is zero, and deflection is zero. So this one is pinned. Deflection is zero, but theta won't be zero. So this has some slope. So the deflection gonna be in this way, in this portion, because this P push it into the concave upward. And then it's gonna be returned back to concave downward by the pink dash line like this. Okay, this is the inflection point, okay? In Thai, we call it jut dat gap. For this one also, you can draw it. And for this one, you can use your ruler. Just test it. Just put the load head here. You will have this shape. Okay, let me go out of this to show you guys about this. So you have intermediate. This is the intermediate beam. Just put this one. You see, at the loading point is downward. But for the other portion, it's gonna move upward. And then if you come like this, okay? And then you push this, the lever's gonna come. There's gonna come something like this, okay? Okay, you can dock it easily by using that. And then you have elastic curve, okay? In the opposite side, in the opposite direction. For the thrust also, we can draw the deformation of the thrust. When you put the 20 kilonewton into this one, point C supposed to move to this C palm. Point B also supposed to move to this B palm. Okay, and since this one has v sub dx equal to v sub dy equal to zero, this is no move, but it can rotate. The same thing occur here, it can rotate, but the v sub ax equal to v sub ay equal to zero. Then you just draw the line, link between each point, okay? Link between each point. And then you can see the shape of this. And you also can imagine this one supposed to be in tension. This one supposed to be in compression, okay? Because when you push thing, it's going to be something like this. This one in tension, this one in compression. And for this one, for sure, this subjected to 30 kilonewton. The deformation here gonna be large. The deformation here gonna be smaller. This one would move V sub AX equal to V sub AY equal to zero. V one V sub what? V sub DX, not equal to zero, is a roller. This one V sub DY supposed to equal to zero. This one under the force is maybe move. Okay, it's maybe move. See, the force under this, when you do this, this one going to be in so-called in tension. That's mean the member here gonna get longer. So I believe the V sub DX gonna be moved from here to here. Okay. And by doing this, the C supposed to be about here. The B supposed to be a little bit about here. So the deformation here gonna get larger. Deformation here gonna get smaller and move this one to be the zero. Okay? And not enough. When the thing there move, okay, there is another thing that must be moved. This one going to be the straight line. The member of the task in tension and in compression, so it still be the straight line. It's going to be the straight line. Okay, unlike the beam. The beam gonna get the curve in some time, but this one, since it is in tension or is maybe in compression, so the deformation gonna be in its direction. So there is no curve for the task member. So this one may be moved downward, and this one also may be moved downward. And then you just link the line between them. I'm sorry, I didn't do good on this. Okay, you will get the new shape of this task. This called an elastic curve. Okay, this is from the computer program, and you can see. Since this one intention, so this one gonna get moved to the right. Okay, come to the frame. This is the fixed support. This is the fixed support. This is no move. So slope here, theta sub c going to equal to deflection cf equal to deflection cy. All of them gonna be zero. And then this is the free end. This is the free end. The important thing of free end is over here, theta sub a won't equal to zero. V sub ax won't equal to zero. V sub ay won't equal to zero. So this one gonna move to this point. And by doing this, V sub Vx is going to be 3.8 millimeter moving in this direction. V sub Ay is 10 millimeter moving downward. And then the last one, if you reference it by the horizontal line, you draw the tangential line, you got this one in the counterclockwise direction. Let's say this is going to be 1.2 and then 10 minus 3 and Le Dian. Again, this time I introduce the unit of the slope. The unit of the slope is in Le Dian. Okay, the unit of slope. And the unit of deflection, unit of deflection is most of the time is in millimeter. And if not millimeter, you may put it 3.810 - 3 meter. Okay, you can use the SI unit of this. Okay, come into this. This one is fixed. This is fixed support. This is free. This is free. Okay, this is going to be the same. Under the application of the force, the point C is supposed to be here. And then since this one is subjected to the moment, if you cut here, you can see this is going to produce the moment. And then it's going to bend this one to what? It's going to bend this one like this. When it's going to bend this one like this, this is going to be concave like this. But since this one it has the axial deformation of AB is very small. Most of the time the B is still at the position here. But if you prefer to keep this one in the right ankle, since this one is the rigid joint. Okay, I introduce you again about rigid joint. When the rigid joint has this ankle, okay, when it's move, okay, it's going to move to the right ankle again. Well, by this one, it's going to move like this. And so I believe this one gonna have the concave downward. And the shape of this is going to be the deflection of this one. And at the C, you may have this one for V sub CY. And you have this one for V sub CX. And then if you measure this with respect to the X direction, you have theta sub C in this clockwise direction, okay? And for the beam, actually, you also have this one for the V sub BY, and this one for the V sub BX. And due to the axial deformation of the structural member is small, most of the time this is zero. That means this point moves to this point. Okay, and then if you measure this, you also have this reference line. This is horizontal reference line. This is the vertical reference line. And then from the reference line to the curve, and then from the reference line to the curve, you will get for the rigid joint, the theta SB measure on the beam or measure on the vertical member, they are gonna be equal. That is the important thing about the rigid joint. Okay. And then we're going to consider the connecting condition. Again, the fixed connected joint, or we call this one as the rigid joint. The thing important is for the rigid joint. Okay. They're going to produce equal theta. But if we have the pin or we have the hinge joint, the theta that is rotated in this one and this one, they won't be equal, okay? But the theta here gonna be equal, and this show the rigid joint, okay? This is going to be subjected to different moment, but what we have is this right ankle, this right ankle must keep the same. If this is not right angle, if this one has the something like this, under this kind of force, okay, this one may check the shape to be something like this. The angle here before and after, they are going to be the same. Okay, no matter it's the right angle or it not right angle, rigid joint, always keep it angle at this position to be the same. Okay, knowing elastic curve of the frame is a little bit more tricky. Right, for this one, let's say for this one is first. This is fixed. This is fixed. This is fixed. The deformation and the theta always are zero. And then when you push this, this one gonna move alongside. And since there is no deformation, if this one is delta, this one will be delta, and this one will be delta also. Okay. And since this is the rigid joint, okay, and what we have for the beam, and when you fold it, what we have to the column, when you push it, if the end is free end, the shape of this gonna be something like this. Since this one connect by the beam, so this one won't be move free like this. Over here must keep its angle, okay? When to keep this one at the right angle, what we have is the deformation here gonna be in the right angle. So when you push this one, the curve here will be concave downward like this, and then it will concave upward. When it's concave upward, it keep the right angle here. This one will produce the shape like this, okay, upward. And then for another one, if you come to check this one will have the deflection like this. And then it will return like this. And also this one have the shape like this. And it will return like this. And everyone will keep its light angle, okay? And then what we have here is going to have the deformation like this one, and then like this one. So we have the inflection point here, okay? This is important for the elastic curve of the frame, okay? And coming into this is the pin. The deflection of the pin over here that is going to have the slope, okay? And this one going to have no slope. Theta here is zero. Theta here won't be zero. But the drawing by using this going to be a lot harder. Again, this has the shape of this green line. So this one will have the shape of this green line and then have the inflection point here and up here. But this one won't. Because since this one is the pin support, let me go out it again. If this is fixed, okay, the shape gonna be like this. If this is fixed, the shape gonna be like this. If this is pin, the shape gonna be something like this. They are different, okay? Since they are different, let me go back again over here. Okay, this one will concave different one, but this one will have only one shape. This one will have only one shape. That means it's going to curve like this. When it's curved like this, it's going to keep the angle here at the right angle. And then on the top of this is also keep it as the right angle. By doing this, what we have is this one going to move downward and this one going to move upward. When it's moved downward and moved downward, what we have is going to have the shape something like this. Okay, so we have the shape here at the shape. This is downward and then change to upward. So we have inflection point over here and over here. Okay, the time is up. I supposed to show you guys a lot about this. Okay, this one again have the dash line close to the yellow line I have. So this P pink have two curve the bottom one and the top one that is the extension point here and also we have the curve on the top of this blue portion and another portion here and we have the curve you may see from this one okay the curve for the frame and then you may draw it by using the moment that the moment positive is going to produce the concave upward like this moment negative going to produce concave downward like this okay for the concave upward that's going to be in compression this one going to be in tension concave downward this is going to be in tension this is going to be in compression okay that is going to help you to analyze it again this one I show you guys already this one going to have the curve like this for this one this is fixed okay this is negative moment so the deformation of this one supposed to get concave like this okay and this one has the positive moment is depend on the side of this moment but for sure this one will concave upward okay you will get the curve like this and for this one this portion has the inflection point here and we will have fixed here so this is going to be negative moment that is going to have the shape like this and for the other have the positive so this one will have the shape like this okay this is going to link here okay and for this one you have the positive here and negative here you have the point of inflection point here so this one for sure is going to have this type of concave upward and this one going to concave downward like this and this is the inflection point okay and what we have the other this is going to be the fixed this is going to be the fixed and the moment is negative here and positive here what we have is the inflection point gonna be here the inflection point gonna be here this one gonna be concave downward this one gonna concave downward and they are concave in the same shape because the load is in symmetry just put this one here so this is fixed and then at the middle we have the what from this one is concave upward that is the point here gonna produce the maximum deflection the slope here gonna be zero and then we have this shape okay this one the point of maximum deflection and slope here is zero so slope here is zero the deflection here is zero because it's fixed in okay it's fixed in and the shape is going to be something here and this is going to be the inflection point see and for this one this is fixed and this can move a little bit because this is what this is the load can elongate นะฮะ can have elongation when this one occur okay we will have the moment like this and this is going to be negative moment this is positive moment this one gonna have the shape like this at here is the inflection point and this one gonna concave upward like this but don't forget about this displacement it is not the roller it is the load so there is a small deformation here okay how about this this is positive by doing this is the roller this can move to here okay this is the pin can have the rotation so this one can rotate by using this moment and then this is the pin and then there is the moment like this the shape going to be something like this so you just put this one into this direction and then if you keep this one as the right angle because this is the rigid joint and then what we have is the deflection here gonna be something like this concave upward
okay, concave upward, you will have this kind of shape. Sorry for this. This is going to concave upward. Okay, the shape is going to be something like this, and then you can see what we have here. And there is a lot of things that you may go to on of this. And I should finish the lecture here. Let your guy go to another class. Next one, I will talking about the elastic beam theory. Okay, thank you very much. And see you again. No, we meet again on the online examination this coming Sunday. And be prepared for that. And come to join the Google Classroom before 7 o'clock, 55 minutes. I recommend you guys to join just 7:50 or even 7:45 to be ready for the test. Okay, so today, that's all I have. And see you later. Take care of yourself. Okay, bye-bye.